Ich hab's gesagt, ich bin wieder sauer. Warum gibt's denn so eine Leute? Meine Fresse. Es könnte unheimlich werden oder gruselig. Disturbing Internet Anomalies. Verstörende Internet-Anomalien. Gut, dass er es übersetzt habe, hat keiner verstanden. Das würde ich mir gerne angucken. Statt True Crime heute merkwürdige Dinge aus dem Internet. Und wir wissen alle, das Internet ist ein Schmelztiegel aus den merkwürdigsten Dingen. Aus den furchtbarsten Dingen teilweise, aber auch ganz komischen Dingen, wo man nicht genau weiß, da unten rechts ist eine Anomalie. Nein, hallo, ich bin keine Störung im Netz. Ja, dann mal gucken. Das könnte gruseliger werden als True Crime, aber es wird zumindest hoffentlich nicht ekelhafter. Wir gucken mal.
Surveillance Cameraman.
Oh, es fängt sofort an.
In 2013, a channel called Surveillance Cameraman was created on YouTube. And although the videos have all been taken down now, only accessible through a handful of internet archives, there was once a time when this channel went so viral that it was even featured in the news and in the Seattle Times newspaper. Although the videos are no longer visible on YouTube, pretty much all of the Surveillance Cameraman videos follow the exact same formula. A man with a camera would walk around the streets of Seattle, go up to random people on the street, get in their personal space, and start recording them without their permission, and...
Okay, warte mal, aber das ist doch das, was ungefähr jeder dritte IRL-Streamer heutzutage macht. Jeder fünfte, jeder sechste. Also einige von denen. Wenige zum Glück. TikToker, sehr viele TikToker auf jeden Fall. Sehr viele TikToker.
Without even bothering to explain to people why he was recording or what he planned to do with the videos in the future. As you can imagine, a lot of people didn't take kindly to having a camera shoved in their face.
Unangenehm.
But when his targets would confront him and ask him what he was doing, he would usually either stay completely silent, make slight grunting noises, or just say something extremely vague like, I'm just recording a video. In some of his videos, people would naturally get pretty mad at him, but Klar. He never seemed to care and just kept on recording, even when being yelled at, chased away by his targets, getting stuff thrown at him, or having his camera even batted away. Most of the time, however, people would just get self-conscious and awkward when they realized they were being recorded and would try to walk away from who they probably assumed was either a stalker or just a jerk with no consideration for their privacy and personal space.
Es gibt aber auch unangenehme Leute und ich meine den Kameramann. Es gibt auch echt unangenehme Leute.
The channel was extremely weird, and if you take a minute to analyze Surveillance Cameraman's actions, it might seem like there wasn't a real purpose to his videos other than to maybe annoy people to get cheap views on YouTube.
Mm.
However, in one of his videos, he says something that suggests there was a deeper meaning to the channel. In his first video ever, he walks up to a young couple studying at a college campus, immediately pulls out his camera and starts recording them without their permission. After a few moments of awkward silence where the couple tries to figure out what's going on, the guy asks Surveillance Cameraman why he's recording them when they're just minding their own business, to which the uploader responds with a question.
Can you ask us why you're taking the video?
Just taking the video.
Okay, well, I don't want to be taking a video.
Why are you so worried about it?
I'm not worried, you're just being annoying.
Look at it this way. You ever go to the grocery store? And now there's like surveillance cameras everywhere?
Yeah.
It's not a big deal.
Okay, well...
It's just a video, I mean...
No, you're just being annoying.
After the video was uploaded, a lot of people started to speculate that maybe the entire point of the channel was to raise awareness.
Aber der Unterschied bei so einem Laden mit der Videokamera ist halt eine Sicherheitskamera und da ist ja auch kein Typ dran attached. Da hängt jetzt nicht irgendwie so ein Sicherheitsbeamter und hält die Kamera und läuft dir dauernd hinterher oder versucht genau dein Gespräch zu hören. Und die meisten Sicherheitskameras hören auch deine Gespräche eben nicht ab.
Awareness about how much we've sacrificed our privacy in today's world. How we've silently consented to institutions to record our every move and use the footage for means we're not 100% aware of. Although, this theory was never officially confirmed by Surveillance Cameraman himself. Even if it were true, putting cameras in strangers' face just to make a point is a pretty obnoxious way to make a social commentary. Throughout the rest of all his videos, there's only-
Du wirst aufgenommen, ohne dass du es erlaubst in solchen Orten. Ja, du brauchst es auch nicht erlauben. Wenn du in den Supermarkt gehst, dann gibst du damit gleichzeitig dein Einverständnis, dass du gefilmt werden darfst vom Supermarkt. Wie das auf öffentlichen Straßen ist, weiß ich nicht genau, aber es macht doch mal einen Unterschied, ob ich einer von vielen bin oder ob jemand direkt hingeht und mich einfach direkt abfilmt. Vor allem, wenn ich gerade im privaten Gespräch irgendwo sitze. Das macht schon Unterschiede.
Almost no further mention of the channel having a deeper meaning. Shortly after the channel was created, a local Seattle news station even made a report on Surveillance Cameraman, heavily leaning into the possibility that the channel was created to comment on a social issue. Shortly after the Seattle.
Stimmt, die Sicherheitsvideos werden nicht einfach online auf einem YouTube-Channel veröffentlicht. Das kommt auch nochmal dazu.
Times even published an article about how the uploader's actions were making a lot of people question the meaning of privacy in the 21st century. Still, because YouTube pretty much wiped the entire channel's videos, it's hard to know the real motivation in recording random people on the street and posting it to YouTube. ForgottenLanguages.org. ForgottenLanguages.org is a very confusing website with all kinds of theories behind its possible meaning, which has led to the creation of a pretty deep rabbit hole around it over the years.
Okay, wenn die Seite alt ist, warum steht da Bücher 2022 bis 24? Und viele Einträge gibt es ja auch nicht wirklich, ne? Oder das sind die letzten 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, die letzten 5, okay.
Upon visiting the site, you'll be greeted with what appears to be a library of strange articles with some very weird images. What makes this website so strange is that none of these articles are legible, as they appear to be written in some sort of unknown language.
Oh, sowas mag ich. Oh, das finde ich irgendwie cool. Die Frage ist nur, könnte man das übersetzen? Wahrscheinlich nicht.
Some of the articles do have snippets of English sprinkled throughout them, but for the most part, they're pretty much impossible to understand. The only way you'd be able to get an idea of what each article is about would be to look at the external documents being referenced in the article and do some reverse engineering to make an educated guess as to the article's subject matter. The further I ventured into the site, the stranger the topics of the articles started to get, with a lot of them being written on things like occult spirituality, alien technologies, the darker side of neuropsychology, and similar topics. Although some people have speculated that the entire site is written in complete gibberish and was just made as a complicated joke, others have claimed to have successfully translated some of the articles with advanced translation software. Many people seem to think ForgottenLanguages.org is the work of a mysterious woman who goes by the name Aindrill, along with 15 other close collaborators who are obsessed with using already existing languages to create a new, universal language that can be understood by living organisms other than humans.
Sins Lobu Girit Tede Zame Af Asfi Mova Tute Hage Kasat weiß nicht, Shunes Ebegit weiß ich nicht.
This is where it's
vor allen Dingen aber, wer hat sich die Mühe gemacht, diese Seite aufzusetzen? Und warum haben Leute sich die Mühe gemacht, da so viele Sachen zusammenzutragen? Das ist nochmal viel faszinierender.
It starts to get a little confusing, as the creators of the website have also allegedly claimed that they made ForgottenLanguages.org to share some sort of secret knowledge with other speakers of the language around the world.
Ja, sicher.
Because some of the articles on the site seem to reference confidential government documents, lots of people have theorized that there's something deeper going on behind the scenes of Forgotten Languages. But so far, none of this has been confirmed. I also found really elaborate association charts made by someone who wanted to find all the people connected to the website. But some of the associations look like a bit too much of a stretch, and it looks more like a conspiracy theory chart than anything else.
Aber spannend. Ich mag so. Ich muss zugeben, ich mag sowas.
Because the owners of Forgotten Languages have been uploading articles to their site for over 15 years, it's hard to believe they're doing it without a real purpose. If it were a hoax or some sort of ARG, this would be a pretty elaborate one.
Also doch, Books 22 bis 24. Die Seite ist gar nicht. Also die Seite ist schon alt, aber die wird immer noch betrieben. Seit 15 Jahren laden die das Shit hoch. Was zum Teufel?
As I later found out, there's also Forgotten Languages YouTube channel with some very strange videos. A couple of other YouTubers have reached out to the channel owners who responded not to worry about the channel as the videos were all made as messages for their members or something like that. It's possible in the future more information on Forgotten Languages will surface, but for now, there's not really a concrete idea as to what the site is actually used for.
Eine universelle Weltsprache wäre so nice. Meinst du Esperanto? Was ist daraus eigentlich geworden?
Thrift Shop SD Cards. In 2014, a channel called Thrift Shop SD Cards was created on YouTube with the intention of uploading strange things that the channel owners found in the memory cards and cameras they bought at thrift stores. Since its creation, only two videos have been uploaded to its channel, with the most recent one dating back to September 2014. In the description of the first video, the uploaders claimed that the video was found on an SD card in an old digital camera around 2004, and that the footage shows two teens looking at what appears to be an abandoned school. As per the caption, there's a weird sound at 49 seconds, after which the two teens mention a moving door and turn the camera off.
Wait a minute, did you see that? Did that door just move? Did you, nope, nope, did you see that? Like, was that a door that just moved?
Because the video ends as soon as one of the teenagers turns around, it's impossible to know what exactly caused the door to move. Still, it's pretty creepy considering the video was allegedly found on a thrift shop camera.
Das Gruseligste ist gerade die Hintergrundmusik.
The second video shows a man staring into the camera and talking about something being in his eyes and asking someone else if they see the things in his eyes too, with no response.
Das sieht einfach aus wie edgy Teenager machen, laden ein paar Videos hoch und wollen ein Internetmysterium machen. Irgendwie sowas. Das wirkt einfach nur so.
According to the uploader, this video was taken in 2003, and although many people have found it a little disturbing, it's more than likely that the guy just had colored contact lenses in his eyes and was going to send the video to a friend asking if he could see them. Although of course this hasn't been confirmed, it's pretty likely.
Das Wichtige ist, dass die Qualität ungefähr bei 120p liegt, ja, damit es noch gruseliger wird.
That's all there is to this video.
Aber na gut, das war vor 9 Jahren, aber ich glaube auch da gab es bessere Kameras.
Help me, Susie's dying. In the UK in the 70s and 80s, there were rumors that if you went to certain telephone booths and dialed a specific number, you would allegedly reach a woman with a flat, monotone voice repeating the same creepy phrase over and over. Help me, Susie's dying. However, on the internet, there's some contradicting information circulating about the whole thing. Many people disagree on the exact number you'd have to dial to reach the disturbing voice, and what the exact message you'd hear was, but the common consensus was that the number was simply 202020, or a similar combination of twos and zeros. Over the years, the story's been reposted all over the internet on forums like 4chan and Reddit, and the first account of the Help Me Susie's Dying story I was able to find dates all the way back to the year 2000. A man from Lancashire named Rob Dickinson wrote about his account of what happened when he and a couple of his friends went into a phone booth in the mid-70s to see if the rumors were true. Rob's account was originally published in the It Happened to Me section of the 14 Times, a British magazine dedicated to publishing people's accounts of their encounters with the odd, paranormal, and mysterious. I found a few more accounts of the same story in the same magazine, and although there was some contradicting information in some of them, they all agreed that the phone booths were located in or around the town of Burnley in the UK, and that the incident took place in the 70s and 80s. These few accounts are the only official sources of information available on the Help Me Susie's Dying incident, which makes it hard to confirm whether any of this is true.
Einfach so einen Anrufbeantworter aufnehmen, irgendwo gibt es bestimmt digital den Service, hinter eine Nummer schalten und die Nummer einfach im Internet verbreiten auf Reddit. Oh, ich hatte mich verwählt, ich wollte eigentlich woanders anrufen, ich habe dann bei Redial geguckt, ich habe die Nummer angerufen und dann kam diese unglaublich mysteriöse und bla 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 und schon geht's los. Und da ist dann einfach nur irgendwas Gruseliges, Mysteriöses oder irgendwas, ja, eigentlich nice, könnte jeder machen.
According to one of the most
super Idee, danke. Ja, ne, finde ich auch ganz geil. Ich will selber gucken, ob ich irgendwo so einen digitalen Anrufbeantworter finde.
Logical and believable theories that surface regarding the disturbing recording. The voice was supposed to be a test, not meant to be heard by the public. And it's possible that due to the bad quality of the recording back in the 70s and 80s, the voice could have been saying something completely different than what the users heard. It's possible that the voice was saying something like, hold please, user dialing, but because of the garbled sound of the recording, the dialer heard, help me, Susie's dying, and the whole story became a case of broken telephone.
Könnte auch sein, smart.
Still, it's possible that some employees at the phone booth company programmed the test recording to say something dark and disturbing as a joke. Sweet Peach. Sweet Peach is an extremely strange YouTube channel.
Ich kenne den Channel und ich weiß auch genau, warum es den gibt.
Created in July 2017, featuring over 17,000 videos that don't seem to make any sense. All of the videos are the same, starting with an image of a couple of barcodes and eventually becoming a jarbled mess of colorful graphics, geometric shapes, and smiley faces while beeping tones can be heard in the background. Although the videos vary in length, most of them range from 2 to 9 minutes long, and despite the insane amount of videos that have been uploaded to the channel over the years, there doesn't seem to be any sort of meaning to Sweet Peach. Many people have come up with all kinds of theories to explain the channel's purpose, but it seems the channel is most similar to another channel called WebDriver Torso.
Den kenne ich auch.
On September 23rd,
624,000 videos. 624,000 videos. Es gibt aber eine Erklärung dafür.
WebDriver Torso started uploading videos at a pretty insane rate, often every 15 to 20 minutes. Similarly to Sweet Peach, the videos consisted of simple slides with colorful graphics and constant beeping noises playing in the background. Although most of the 624,000 videos uploaded to the channel were pretty much the same, the channel gained a lot of public attention in 2014 when a couple of users found what appeared to be jokes sprinkled throughout some of the videos. As the videos gained attention online, YouTube eventually admitted that the channel had been created by their performance engineers as an internal testing tool for visuals and audio.
So gut, aber es ist ein YouTube-Channel, wo die einfach Techniktests gemacht haben. Voll geil. Haben nie gerechnet damit, dass man den findet.
And in 2017, WebDriver Torso stopped posting videos at the same crazy fast rate. Still, WebDriver Torso remains active to this day, still posting videos on occasion.
Voll geil.
Considering its similarities to WebDriver Torso, it's possible that Sweet Peach is just another automated performance testing account. Otherwise, I can't really think of a good reason to have a channel like this. The Stinky Meat Project.
Ich glaube, die meinen dich.
Stinkymeat.net is probably one of the strangest, most disgusting websites hidden in the corners of the internet. It's not necessarily disturbing, just incredibly weird. As per the website's description, the Stinky Meat Project was created in the summer of 2000 by a guy named Malin Smith, who...
Three kinds of meat, 19 days and 1 million maggots, and stuck them in the yard of my unwitting neighbor. Was? The neighbor eventually found the meat in his yard. Fortunately, I wasn't arrested, so I was free to do it all over again the following summer. This site answers burning scientific questions such as where do maggots come from, what's the smell? Alter, fantastischer Nachbar. Was für ein fantastischer Nachbar.
Who thought it would be a good idea to take three different kinds of meat, put them on a plate, and place them in his neighbor's yard to see what would happen if he left the meat to rot. Long story short, because he never got arrested for his antics in his neighbor's yard, he decided to turn the Stinky Meat Project into something a little bit bigger. Over the years, Malin Smith and a couple of his friends have been taking different kinds of raw meat and documenting what happens when they leave the meat in random locations such as libraries, malls, parks, backyards, and even on top of their computers. The whole project consists of them going back to the meat they've left in different locations, checking to see how disgusting it gets over time, and uploading the pictures to their site as...
Das Ding ist, wenn die es bei sich zu Hause machen, okay, ja, kann ein lustiges Projekt sein, kann stinken, wie es fröhlich ist, aber sobald die halt da mit anderen Leuten auf den Sack gehen, andere Leute benachteiligen oder sonst irgendwas, holy shit, ganz ehrlich, die sollten das fressen müssen. So, ich hab's gesagt, ich bin wieder sauer. Warum gibt's denn so eine Leute? Meine Fresse.
As well as some descriptions of what they had to go through for the meat to end up where it did. There doesn't seem to be much more to it. The sheer effort they've put into the whole thing is pretty insane. Over time, Malin and his friends have even made some merch with the Stinky Meat Project logo on t-shirts, and it appears they even had a bit of a fan base at their peak.
Natürlich.
It seems the project is no longer active, but the website definitely still is, and probably will be for a while. Floating Chinese City. In 2015, a video of what appeared to be a floating city in the clouds above the Chinese city of Foshan started circulating everywhere online, and after it was covered in several news stations around the world, all kinds of theories started surfacing regarding the video's origin. The quality of the video itself is pretty bad, but because it was allegedly shot on a cloudy day, it doesn't immediately look fake. Despite the fact that even sources like
Colombia,
like CNN covered it, nobody really knows who shot the video or where it came from, which is pretty strange regardless of whether it's real or not. As you can imagine, as soon as some of the more credible news sources began speculating about the video's origin, people started throwing around all kinds of conspiracy theories, with some people claiming that the footage is undeniable evidence of the so-called Bluebeam Project. According to the now-deceased Canadian writer and poet Sergei Monast, Project Bluebeam was NASA's effort to broadcast holograms of the Second Coming of Christ all over the world. ...to implement a totalitarian takeover of Earth by the New World Order.
Okay. What else is new? Was gibt's sonst noch?
Although this is one of the wilder theories regarding the video's origin for sure, some of the other more credible theories that have also gained traction over the years suggest there's a more plausible explanation for the video of the floating city. According to one of the most believable ones, the floating city could have been a real video of something called a Fata Morgana, which is basically an optical illusion or a mirage caused by light rays being bent by extremely dense air trapped by alternating layers of warm and cold. This phenomenon sometimes causes boats and ships on the ocean to look as if they're floating above the water in the distance, or that there's water in the distance on the road. Still, to say the floating city looks anything like what even the most impressive Fata Morgana usually looks like is a huge stretch.
Es sieht am Anfang ein bisschen aus wie ein Codec-Fehler von einer Wolke irgendwie.
Missing the very real possibility that the video was somehow faked.
Wahrscheinlich das. Sehr wahrscheinlich das. Warum haben die Videos immer so eine Scheißqualität? Genau wie Geistersichtungen. Weißt du? Heute jeder Arsch in jedem Gerät eine 4K-Kamera, an jeder Straßenecke, bla. Sobald ein Geist zu sehen ist, 120p-Video, oh, ein Geist, did you see it? Auf einmal kann keiner mehr filmen und auf einmal kann keine Kamera mehr filmen.
Project Red Sun. In 2012, supposed footage...
Ist gefaked, siehe Captain Disillusion. Okay, die Stadt wurde also schon debunked. Okay. Wo wundert mich nur begrenzt, wenn ich ehrlich bin.
Footage of a secret NASA mission to Mars in 1973 started gaining massive traction online. Many people bought...
Ich muss auch kurz zurückspulen. Project Red Sun.
In 2012, supposed footage of a secret NASA mission to Mars in 1973 started gaining massive traction online. Many people bought into the theory that NASA had launched a covert project codenamed Project Red Sun in the late 60s and early 70s to land human beings on Mars and establish relationships with aliens without the general public noticing. The footage itself starts with a blue screen warning viewers that the video is not meant for public distribution.
Natürlich.
After which we see 3 minutes of blurry, wobbly footage of the supposed Mars landing. At first glance, it's hard to know what to make of the video, and it's not hard to see why many conspiracy theorists tried to position the footage as proof that NASA had been working with aliens for the past 50 years while keeping the public completely in the dark.
Wie normale Leute filmen? Ja, und wie Conspiracy Theorists filmen? Warum? Warum?
The most logical
halt doch einmal die Kamera still, Junge! Wir wollen auch was sehen!
Some people have claimed that the footage is the work of the Faking Hoaxer, a small channel on YouTube that has released similar footage in the past and promoted it as real. It might also be worth mentioning that John Moonwalker, the YouTuber who originally uploaded the video back in 2012, has uploaded similar videos of questionable origin in the past. The most popular video on his channel, uploaded 14 years ago, is titled Apollo 17 Alien Encounter, and it shows some obviously edited footage of a moon landing. So, just with that, we have to take everything published by the channel with a grain of salt. A lot of people seem to favor the idea that the footage was created using some of NASA's still images of Mars and manipulating them with some basic editing software. But there are of course people in small pockets of the internet that still believe this is real, despite the overwhelming evidence against it.
Geil, ich glaube, ich will den schnell abonnieren. Warte.
In small pockets of
Six Most Disturbing Burglars, das will ich gucken. Most Disturbing Webstars und das will ich auch gucken. Ich glaube, ich will den Channel abonnieren. Ich glaube, wir müssen ab und zu mal reingucken. Fand ich gerade ganz gut eigentlich. War jetzt nicht so unfassbar disturbing. Ich bin jetzt nicht ganz disturbed. Ja, ich bin so 20% disturbed, 80% relaxed. So bin ich hier gerade. Das ist mein Gemütszustand. Ich weiß, wie es bei euch ist. Ich glaube, 20 war sogar noch übertrieben. Ich bin eigentlich relativ ruhig. Fühle mich jetzt wenig verunsichert durch dieses Internet. Dann, ja gut, eins können wir noch. Eins machen wir noch. Eins machen wir noch, aber erstmal schicke ich euch einen Link zu dem hier raus, damit ihr mich ein Like da lassen könnt, ja. Und natürlich auch ein Abo bei diesem Channel, den wir noch nie gesehen haben vorher, aber ab sofort ein paar Mal noch reingucken werden. So machen wir's, ja, genau so machen wir's. Auf YouTube vielen Dank fürs Zuschauen und bis zum nächsten Video. Ciao.